The pyramids of Egypt were not built to be tombs. In fact, they were something far more sophisticated, a technology of some kind. And in this video, I'm going to connect the dots on key pieces of evidence from videos that I've made ranging from Nikola Tesla to the ancient Egyptians. And I believe that Nikola Tesla's concept for wireless free energy right out of the Earth's crust is the missing key to understanding this lost ancient technology. Because make no mistake, the ancient Egyptians that we learned about in school from 4,500 years ago did not construct the Great Pyramid of Giza or the Sphinx. And real quick, no, this is not a video about aliens or some conspiracy. No, the truth is stranger than fiction. And the true history of ancient human civilization is far older and was far more advanced than what we were taught in school. Take, for example, the Great Sphinx of Giza. Hundreds of professional geologists from around the world have concluded that the water rain erosion around the enclosure of the Sphinx is so significant that this had to have happened in prehistoric times. Keep in mind that the Sphinx is carved out of this limestone bedrock, so the age of the erosion has to be the age of the Sphinx, no less. And considering the fact that the Nile Delta region has not received significant rainfall since 7,000 BC, or 9,000 years ago, more than double the age of this 4,200-year estimate. In fact, evidence outlined by Dr. Robert Schock, a doctor from Yale University, has concluded that the evidence is so significant that it would have required at least 20 to 30,000 years of heavy rainfall in order to cause this type of erosion. And hundreds of other professional geologists who do this for a living have said the same thing. Something particularly interesting about that 30,000-year estimate is the fact that there are two pieces of evidence from the ancient Egyptians that detail lineage of the pharaohs dating back more than 30,000 years, which has always been dismissed by mainstream archaeologists and Egyptologists. So just to clarify what we're dealing with here, the scientific evidence proves that the Great Sphinx was constructed in prehistoric times, which leads right up to the Sumerians, who I'll be mentioning later in this video. I'm not suggesting that the dynastic Egyptians from 4,500 so years ago did not mess around with ancient Egypt, that they did not do things to the casing stones of the Great Pyramid of Giza. In fact, we already know that somebody had reshaped the Sphinx's head. But when you look into the details of the internal structure of the Great Pyramid of Giza, and I made a video on this, and I'll of course include a link that will pop up at the end of this video, it's not hard to see that this is something far different than a tomb, and the evidence to completely suggest that it wasn't a tomb is so overwhelming. Besides the fact that there was never one single mummy found in any of the pyramids of Giza, which most people don't realize, the only evidence to even suggest that these were tombs is this sarcophagus-shaped box found inside the king's chamber. However, this box was constructed with tooling that was far less superior than whatever cut and carved these massive stone blocks inside the king's chamber itself and throughout the pyramid with seemingly laser-cut precision. Take, for example, this shaft inside the king's chamber, a watertight shaft that was formed from three different pieces of stone. I mean, talk about doing something as difficult as possible. What's far more likely is that the same ego-driven pharaoh who reshaped the Sphinx's head probably came in here thousands of years ago and said, hey, I want to be buried in here. And when you consider that the passageway inside and out of the king's chamber cannot fit the sarcophagus, all the evidence indicates, and as you can see in these photos here, that this was once something else, and they simply reshaped it and broke it in the process and used these terrible cutting tools in order to shape it. I mean, just look at the missing floor tiles that were there, and I would even argue that maybe there was no tiles or flooring in that spot altogether, and that you're simply looking at the debris of whatever was once there, whatever it was, and essentially what we're now looking at is a massive misrepresentation of whatever the original structure was. And we also have to keep in mind that as we keep finding these massive chambers and unknown cavities inside the pyramid itself, we just don't know everything there is to know about it. But as I've outlined in a different video, every single theory that has been proposed by Egyptologists and archaeologists on how the ancient Egyptians could have cut and carved stone has been debunked. Besides the fact that they haven't even found saws that could have done this, or even of the size, when they've tested these methods anyways, every single one of them completely failed. And here's what that thumbnail looks like. I recommend you watch this video at the end as I include various video clips that show that every method just could not have done it. Which I believe is further evidence to suggest that the Pyramid of Giza was constructed in prehistoric times. We don't know who, how, or when, just like with the Great Sphinx. I mean, wouldn't that explain why, out of the tens of thousands of hieroglyphs and petroglyphs located throughout ancient Egypt, not one single one of them, zero, mentions anything whatsoever about the Sphinx or the pyramids? Isn't that really odd? So as I mentioned, this structure would have been something far more sophisticated, and I believe that it involves Nikola Tesla's theory and concept for wireless energy. And it's really hard to imagine charging your cell phone out of a stack of bricks and blocks, but let's just move into what we do know. The largest structures that are built by man are dams and facilities for generating electricity. And when you consider just how close the Nile River used to be, in fact, 8 miles closer to the pyramids, going right up to the steps, actually, as you can see evidence here from where the water line used to be. When you combine that with newfound evidence, although this dates back several years now, that there is a massive complex of tunnels, chambers, and caves underneath the Giza Plateau. It has been described as being a massive aquifer. And you can see evidence of these shafts even right on top of the Giza Plateau, these massive shafts that are plummeting more than 100 feet down, many of them. And keep in mind, this isn't cut out of dirt or sandstone. This is limestone bedrock. And there are many of them. And some of them, you can even tell, and this is a few photos courtesy of Brian Forrester, that they seem to channel water. And as you can see in other chambers or shafts, I should say, they connect to horizontal tunnels. And there's other evidence of this on the plateau as well. So when you consider the fact that there's a massive cave, tunnel, and chamber system underneath the pyramids that they haven't even excavated, at least so they say. I mean, isn't that weird? And the fact that we don't even know everything that's inside the Great Pyramid itself. We have to start asking questions. And when Nikola Tesla adamantly stated that he had created the technology to harness energy out of the Earth's crust, and you may remember the Tesla Tower, which was, by the way, built above an aquifer. Yet for some reason, J.P. Morgan decided to remove his funds. And for some reason, I mean, he just stood to make more money doing other things. Nikola Tesla was so adamant that he had mastered this ability, this knowledge on how to harness energy from the Earth, that he wrote J.P. Morgan nearly one letter every single month for 5 years, insisting that he had mastered this technology and he needed the funds in order to complete it. In fact, a month before Tesla's death, he was telling people that he had perfected this and had the intellectual property. And as you can see here, this is all that's left. It never came to fruition. What's interesting is that Nikola Tesla is somebody that's known for outstanding character and integrity. And 80% approximately of the technology that we use every single day in our lives is a direct result of either his works or inventions. He's the guy that mastered the technology for the AC current, which of course powers virtually the entire electrical grid of the entire world. He also invented the electric motor. Most people take for granted on just how many different things they use in their lives. And here's just a couple examples. Every single day that use an electric motor. Most people don't even know who Tesla was. He also invented the remote control and even the radio as the Supreme Court overruled the patent that was awarded to Marconi and received it back to Tesla following his death. Even various aspects of his inventions and the works that he had done, others went on to complete the television, the computer, the laser, the X-ray, robotics, can all be credited to Tesla's earliest works and his lifelong achievements. He also, in 1926, epically described a cell phone as well as the FaceTime and Skype applications. And press pause real quick to read this. So when Tesla was adamant that he had perfected the ability to harness energy from the Earth, should we really doubt him? So if the Great Pyramid of Giza was somehow a structure that could harness energy out of the Earth, as I am suggesting, I think it's the most likely possibility, maybe it was something else. It wasn't a tomb, so we have to ask questions, and there are many different theories. But when you look at the exact location of the Great Pyramid of Giza, many people don't realize that it's located at the precise geographical center of all landmass of planet Earth, keyword landmass. And many people also are not aware that this was going to be the location, the pyramids of Giza were going to be the location of the prime meridian. And back in the 1800s, when they had to vote on this, they decided to go with Greenwich, England, because of London's harbor and incredibly busy shipping lanes in and out of the English Channel, which are still the busiest on planet Earth. So in order to reduce confusion with time zones, they chose Greenwich, England over the Giza Plateau. Isn't that fascinating that the most largest, most mysterious, and precise structure ever built just so happens to be located in this location? Perhaps this has something to do with the ability to harness energy out of the ground. We have to ask ourselves, why did whoever built this, why did they choose to make it so big and so tall? Why these specific measurements? And keep in mind, we don't even know where that capstone is, and many have theorized it could have been gold, which would, of course, be great for transmitting electricity, but also would explain why it's, well, missing and stolen. So as we discuss the measurements of the pyramid, you need to look into the works of Randall Carlson. I'll include links for his website and YouTube channel. I highly recommend that you look into his works. It's unbelievable. He takes all the calculations, notable calculations, of the exact measurements of the Great Pyramid, And he compares it to the measurements of planet Earth. And what he found is that there is a precise ratio that the Great Pyramid of Giza equates to 1 in 43,200 scale of the Northern Hemisphere. So why does that matter? That's a number. Who cares, right? It has to be a ratio of something. But that number, 432, as you see, just so happens to be shared from other ancient civilizations and cultures dating back thousands of years, whether it's the combination of the Sumerian king lists or the Kali Yuga. So if the Great Pyramid of Giza is supposed to represent the Northern Hemisphere, you may be surprised to know that if you take half the minutes in a day, that equals 43,200 seconds. Yet, if you were to say that, okay, well, if that's half the Earth, what about a full representation? Two pyramids, one for the Northern Hemisphere, one for the Southern Hemisphere. That would equal the shape what's referred to as an octahedron, which just so happens to equate to 1,440 degrees. Well, when you look at how many hours there are in a day, it equates to 1,440 minutes. Let's make a comparison for the sun, the radius being 432,000 miles, with the diameter being 864,000 miles. Look at those numbers, 432 and 864, and then compare that a full day in time for minutes, 1440, equals 864 for seconds, 86,400. Again, if you look at these zeros, we can easily say we're just playing with numbers. But is it possible that these numbers have some meaning? Because let's not forget that our very system of time and measurement of time and our calendar is all based off of the size and rotation speed of the Earth as well as our orbit around the sun. So when I mentioned earlier with the Sumerians, one of the earliest pieces of documentation of any kind, they somehow knew about the solar system. And they're also the creators of the modern calendar and system of time that we use today. And it's a complete mystery on how they figured this out, because you have to know specific information of the cosmos to figure that out. These numbers aren't an accident for how many minutes and seconds and hours there are. But when you just look at that number, 432, and how it connects to other civilizations from across the world dating back thousands of years, is it just an accident? Combine that with Nikola Tesla stating that to find the secrets of the universe, you must think in terms of energy, frequency, and vibration. Just think about it. Atoms that we're made up of are a frequency. Whether we're talking your Wi-Fi, your TV channel, your radio station, everything operates on a completely different frequency. Just think about these things we take for granted. Even a microwave, it heats up your food through waves, a very specific frequency. Even consider radioactive material, which many consider to be the source of energy and heat inside of planet Earth. The name itself, radioactive. That same material that powers entire cities, nuclear submarines, and aircraft carriers for decades on end is essentially providing energy that is simply in the form of a frequency. Now consider Nikola Tesla's emphasis on numbers. When you bring back that information to the Great Pyramid of Giza, inside the King's Chamber, that watertight shaft, which is incredible in and of itself, it just so happens to be measured in 8.4 inches by 4.8. 8.4 by 4.8, 4.8 by 8.4. Considering on just how precise and accurate it is that an accident? What I'm suggesting here is that these numbers do matter, that the gateway to understanding a frequency of energy giving off from the Earth's crust, as Nikola Tesla was adamant that he had perfected, somewhere lies in ratios and numbers. And maybe that number 432 is significant. And going back throughout the internal structure of the Great Pyramid, when you look at the Grand Gallery or in other chambers and other pyramids, the insane sound, resonance, and acoustic abilities that are just mind-boggling, is that really just an accident? Is it possible that what we're looking at here is some sort of device that could harness energy, a frequency, that people could tap into for energy, a source of power? You know, it's interesting. If you go back just a couple hundred years and were to talk about cell phones and cars and airplanes and whatever, Wi-Fi, people would just dismiss it. What I'm suggesting is that the Great Pyramid of Giza is over our head. The most likely situation is that human civilization dates back far older and was far more advanced than we ever realized, and they were wiped out a very long time ago. Won't this explain all the similarities of the ancient civilizations across multiple continents around the world, such as the use of pyramids, the incredible similarities of structure and stone cutting, cultural similarities in gold and funeral masks? This would explain the massive holes inside the theory of the human migration process. I mean, why are we finding Aboriginal DNA in South American mummies but not North America? Doesn't that suggest that they just skipped over North America altogether? How did they get there? Or the DNA evidence that shows that there is Middle Eastern DNA inside of Native Americans. What is that about? And then we look at other stories popping up this year. Evidence of humans in North America going back more than 130,000 years ago, and nobody can explain why. The solution is simple. We're talking about a period of time where humans were once advanced enough to travel the world. The evidence has long since gone. When you're talking about thousands of years, and I've used this example before when it comes to the Titanic, more than 50% gone after just over 100 years underwater. And although things erode quicker underwater, when you look at cars and houses and just how fast they erode, did you know that it's theorized that if every human disappeared off planet Earth today, the longest lasting structure would be the Hoover Dam, and they estimate that it'll fall apart in about 10,000 years. We just seem to take for granted just how long of a period of time thousands and tens of thousands of years truly is. Anything that's man-made goes away, except for things made out of stone, like the pyramids or the Sphinx. And now that all the evidence shows that whoever was living in Egypt a few thousand years ago just could not have done these things. And the suggestive evidence that there was advanced knowledge of the cosmos as well as planet Earth. When you piece together all the things that I've outlined in this video, and you connect the dots, it's abundantly clear that the true history of ancient human civilization is far older and was far more advanced than we were taught in school. And it's time that we start asking new questions, because whatever the Great Pyramid of Giza was, we need to find out. It's clearly important. Whatever it was, it's worth knowing about, because something happened to ancient human civilization to wipe them out. So maybe we have something to learn from the past. So I'll wrap it up there. I'm Jimmy. This is Bright Insight. Like and subscribe. Leave me a comment. Let me know what your thoughts are. And I have many other videos coming and a whole wide variety of topics soon. Take care.